Greetings. Let's continue with part 3, answering a set of questions asked by a Muslim brother. Why can't God forgive our sins? And in many places, God will forgive sins if you confess. We're looking at the biblical examples where sins are forgiven. It's not as simple or cut and dried as some might state. We've already seen two examples. Matthew 6:11, give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts, sins, as we forgive our debtors, those who sin against us. I called this case conditional forgiveness. Luke 5:20, when he, Jesus, saw their faith, he, meaning Jesus, said to him, Man, your sins are forgiven you. I called this forgiveness by faith. Let's press on to another example of forgiveness of sins. John 8:24. That is why I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. This does not reveal the context, which discusses dying in your sins. Follow along with me, because while this is not as directly on point, stating your sins are forgiven, the concept of dying in your sins must surely relate to those sins applying, having not been forgiven. The context here is Jesus speaking to the people, including the Pharisees, who were there questioning and challenging him. John 8:21. Again he said to them, I am going away and you will look for me, but you will die in your sin. Where I am going, you cannot come. So Jesus, Yeshua, tells the Pharisees they will die in their sins. So the Jews began to ask, will he kill himself, since he says, where I am going, you cannot come? Think about it, that's a pretty quick guess, given the context. Then he told them, you are from below, I am from above. You are of this world. I am not of this world. Where does Jesus claim to be God? I am not of this world is an unusual thing to say. That is why I told you that you would die in your sins. For unless you believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. They will die in their sins, with their sins unforgiven, unless they do something. Unless you believe that I am He. Unless you believe Jesus, Yeshua, is He, quote unquote. He who? He, the Son of Man. Who are you? They asked. Just what I have been telling you from the beginning, Jesus replied. Pay attention. Try to keep up. Just what I have been telling you from the beginning. I've told you before. I'm gonna explain it to you again, Lucy. I have much to say about you and much to judge, but the one who sent me is truthful, and what I have heard from him, I tell the world. Jesus teases a reference to the prophet of Deuteronomy 18 with this. Deuteronomy 18:18. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell them everything I command him. I will put my words in his mouth, and he will tell them everything I command him. And what I have heard from him, I tell the world. They did not understand that he was telling them about the Father. You think? So Jesus said, when you have lifted up the Son of Man. Here, Jesus foretells his death by crucifixion. When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am He. Then you will know that I am the Son of Man, and that I do nothing on my own, but speak exactly what the Father has taught me. Have you figured out yet I am the prophet Moses foretold and God promised? If you haven't, You may fall for the lie some man named Muhammad will claim. He who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, because I always do what pleases him. Pay attention to this phrase. He has not left me alone. I believe Jesus, even emptied of his deity, had never been left alone by God the Father, until finally, during the crucifixion, God did for the first time, which precipitated Jesus' exclamation from the cross. At the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" An event that prophet David foretold in the Psalms. Psalm 22:1, a Psalm of David. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my words of groaning?" John 8:24, "That is why I told you that you would die in your sins. For unless you believe that I am He, you will die in your sins." Let's call this case recognition of the Son of Man. But does declaring Jesus is the Son of Man need some explanation? Most definitely yes. First, do not confuse the Son of Man with a son of a human man, meaning a typical human being. The title Son of Man expressly comes from a prophecy by Daniel. Daniel 7:13, "In my vision in the night I continued to watch, and I saw one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. And he was given dominion, glory, and kingship, that the people of every nation and language should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed." This is who the Son of Man is. This is who Jesus said he was when Jesus called himself the Son of Man. Do you believe Jesus will be given an eternal kingdom by God the Father? I suspect that belief is a critical foundation of saying, "I believe Jesus is the Son of Man," if your purpose and intent is to avoid dying in your sins. Remember, I am answering a question from a Muslim in search of the truth. And in many places, God will forgive sins if you confess. There are certainly instances where God forgives sins outside the sacrifice of blood. But blood sacrifice is such a foundational truth, it is repeatedly referenced in the New Testament. But all these examples we're looking at are before the crucifixion. Remember, context, context, context. Now, Jesus has established a new covenant, a new agreement, if you will. Hebrews 10:1. "For the law is only a shadow of the good things to come, not the realities themselves. It can never, by the same sacrifices offered year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. If it could, would not the offerings have ceased? For the worshippers would have been cleansed once for all, and would no longer have felt the guilt of their sins. Instead, those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins, because it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins." Allow that to sink in and percolate. "Because it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, 'Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you took no delight.'" Note the quotes. Jesus is again revealing Old Testament prophets who foretold Jesus, his mission, even his words. Psalm 40 verse 6, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but my ears you have opened. Burnt offerings and sin offerings you did not require." Then I said, "Here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, O God." Psalm 40 verse 7, "Then I said, Here I am, I have come. It is written about me in the scroll. I delight to do your will, O my God." In the passage above, he says, "Sacrifice and offerings, burnt offerings and sin offerings, you did not desire, nor did you delight in them, although they were offered according to the law." The Apostle Paul is a brilliant teacher. Then he adds, "Here I am, I have come to do your will." He takes away the first to establish the second. And by that will, we have been sanctified through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ, once for all. Day after day, every priest stands to minister and to offer again and again the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when this priest had offered for one time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. Psalm 110, verse 1. "The Lord said to my Lord, Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." Hebrews 1:13. "But to which of the angels has he at any time said, Sit on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool?" Since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made a footstool for his feet, because in a single offering, he has made perfect for all time those who are being sanctified. The Holy Spirit also testifies to us about this. First, he says, "This is the covenant I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts and inscribe them on their minds." Jeremiah 33:33. "But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and inscribe them on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they will be my people." The Apostle Paul continually referenced the message of the prophets in his teachings. Then he adds, "Their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more." And where these have been forgiven, an offering for sin is no longer needed. Think about that. The new covenant, when established, means sins have been forgiven. Some may consider the implications heretical, but let's look at one of my favorite passages. John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that everyone who believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." As beautiful and magnificent as that is, too many stop reading right there. "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." Remember, God sent Jesus to save the world, not only the elect. The slogan, "Elect Lives Matter," is not Christian. All lives matter. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe has already been condemned. Pay attention to why they are already condemned. Because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. Here it does not mention sins or dying in your sins. But we know that is involved. That is why I told you that you would die in your sins. For unless you believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. But also remember, this is Jesus talking to Jewish Pharisees before the crucifixion. And the sacrifice that takes away the sins of the world has not happened yet. And this is the verdict, that light has come into the world, but men loved the darkness rather than the light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and does not come into the light for fear that his deeds, which are evil, will be exposed. But whoever practices the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen clearly that what he has done has been accomplished in God. Why can't God forgive our sins? And in many places, God will forgive sins if you confess. I think there is some scriptural evidence to consider the possibility Jesus already has. 1 Timothy 2:3, this is good and pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who wants everyone, all, to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Sincerely pray for those who only think their group matters. There are real situations where the universe has not provided equality, nor have the governments of men, whether royal or elected. Only God grants possible equality of eternal outcome for all mankind. However, that opportunity is but for a little while longer. 2 Thessalonians 2:10, because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned or damned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Pursue the truth. Love the truth. Jesus is that truth. Luke 21:36. Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. The bridegroom is coming. Shouldn't we prepare ourselves for him? Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. Don't be distracted or dismayed by the things that are coming and have begun. Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of Man. Amen.